Hey everyone, welcome to this very new series on the Codex CLI by OpenAI. Now, many of you know that I am a true blue Claude Code user. In fact, I've done 10 episodes on how you can get the best out of Claude Code. But I'm sure that you've been hearing the news all about people who have been moving over from Claude Code to Codex CLI. And I'll be really honest with you, I gave Codex a try several times before, and I was not very impressed. In fact, I was turned off by how the visual interface looked, the lack of functionality, and even though there was a good argument for GPT-5, I really didn't feel that convinced about having to switch over. However, given the amount of news and hype that's gone around about Codex, I thought I would actually spend the time to do a deeper investigation, looking at what other users were doing. And I'll tell you now, I'm really glad I did that because my mind has been changed. I think the Codex CLI is an extremely powerful tool, and you really owe it to yourself to give it a shot. In today's tutorial, I'm going to give you an accelerated tour of everything I wish I knew about Codex when I first started using it. And this is just hours, days, and even weeks of investigating Codex properly. And you definitely want to watch this entire video till the end, because in addition to sharing everything that I've learned, I will also be telling you how you can get hold of a tool that I've made that will help you get up and running with using Codex in the fastest possible way. And on the topic of investigating Codex, I thought it would be worthwhile just showing you an overview of how I went about doing my research for Codex. So what I did was actually make use of Vector AI. I'm just going to create a new project just to show you how easy it was to get started with this. So what I did was research about OpenAI's Codex CLI. And the great thing about this is that you don't really need to write a prompt here. You can actually use generate system prompt. So you can see here, it's already set up a good goal, which is researching the Codex CLI comprehensively. And then it's going to act as a technical research analyst. And it's going to do some detailed research around this. So I'm just going to click create project over here. All right, so now that that's done, I'm just going to select it in this left-hand side over here. Make sure that I'm using one of the state-of-the-art models. So GPT-5 thinking is probably the best one, and also in theme with today's video anyway. I'm trying to come up with the top 5 things that everyone should know about the Codex CLI. Browse the web and the books especially. And then create 5 actionable steps to thoroughly understand this. The great thing about it is it has actually got a built-in Perplexity Pro account to perform the research for you as well. And you can see here it's going to provide you with a great way to get a good understanding of what's going on. One of the things that I really liked was having this idea inbox. Whenever I came across something on Twitter or a GitHub repository or any tip that I found useful, I would just very quickly pop into here so that I would have this repository of knowledge to get follow. I then asked Vector to study both the ideas and the notes and then come up with a plan for me to be able to investigate everything related to Codex as well as prepare today's video. If you want to try Vector out yourself, you should click on the link in the description below. And what's more, right now, Vector has unlimited GPT-5 usage and you can get a free 30 days use of Vector Pro. All you have to do is use the code right here during checkout and this will give you access to all of the cutting edge AI models plus everything else that Vector has to offer. Head on over to the link in the description below to try it out. And thanks to Vector for sponsoring today's video. And now without further ado, let's get started with today's tutorial. All right, so the first thing you really want to do is run Codex with this search parameter specified, because this will allow you to do things like look up and summarize the docs at this URL over here. And if you don't specify that, you will find that it's not going to be able to access anything on the internet. This search functionality is super crucial in order for it to continue to search through the web to find the information that it needs. And I do think it's quite silly that it's not turned on by default. So the way that you can solve this problem is doing the following. So if you just open up your bash RC file, and this can be your ZSH RC file if you're on a Mac, you do Codex, and then you do --- search. If you save this, you can either source your bash RC or your ZSH RC, or you can simply relaunch another terminal so it picks it up. And now if you do CS, it actually will run this automatically for you. And this is the pattern using aliases that you'll see very useful when it comes to Codex. All right, so the next thing that I want to highlight is if you actually look at what you're using as a model, the way that Codex defines it is that you have your model as well as your reasoning effort. And it always defaults to this medium reasoning by default. But the truth is that you probably want to maximize your reasoning in most cases. It's almost like if you want to make use of Opus versus Sonnet when you're using Claude Code, most of the time you want to be in Opus mode until you've run out of your quota or if you're doing something really, really rudimentary. So you can easily switch it by typing model and then going down to high, but this is really annoying. So let's actually set it by default. You can actually override configurations like this. So you can do Codex and then you do --m for GPT-5. And then from here you do -c, model, reasoning, effort, equals to high. And this means that you will always start off with your reasoning effort being high. And you can double check this by typing model. You can see that you've always been high. And once again, the way that you want to do this is you can add on to your alias here. I'll see create a new one called CH, and you can do codex search and then do minus C and then model reasoning effort high. New terminal and type CH, you can automatically get the search as well as your reasoning model set without having to type in the long commands again. And this is a quick and hacky way to create shortcuts to set up Codex in a way that is actually practical for your use case. And remember to stay tuned to the end. I'll show you a tool that I made that allows you to utilize all these extra things without using aliases. For this next topic, it's going to be about sandbox and approval modes. And I tell you that and this is the number one thing that trips up so many people when they get started with using Codex. If you're coming from Cloud Code, you know that you basically have this notion of permissions, and that's it. If you look through the documentation, you can be very quickly overwhelmed by what the difference is between the sandbox and approval ratings, as well as how you actually combine both of them together for your different modes and intents. Rather than going through the theory about all of this, I'm going to distill this information into the simplest possible way so you can get started using Codex. And all you have to do is just stick through the next 1 to 2 minutes, and you'll probably be ahead of 90% of the people who try out Codex and give up because of how they get tripped up by this. The main thing that you really just want to understand here is that there are sandboxes and there are approvals. And when it comes to approvals, it's always about, will Codex be asking me a question before moving ahead? Can I do this? Am I allowed to write this? Am I allowed to run this command? Very similar to Cloud Code's permissions. Now, the difference with a sandbox is that think of these as physical boundaries. If your sandbox has physically closed off your file system, even if you give approval, it's still not going to be able to do it. So think of sandboxes as the physical constraints that have been placed on it. The sandbox is like your house, right? If you physically locked your doors to your rooms, even if people ask you for permission, they're not going to be able to get inside. Conversely, if you literally let anybody in a house, you're relying on the fact that they're going to be asking you for permission before doing something, but technically, they're still going to be able to peek in because of the fact that everything is not closed off. So that's the easiest way of understanding the difference between the approvals and sandbox. And like I mentioned, AI has given you lots of different combinations in order for different use cases. But I find that this is way too complicated. I'm just going to show you a practical way of just having two additional combinations in addition to the default one, and that should set you up for 90% of the workflows, okay? So the best way to think about this is the following. Just focus on these three combinations. One of it is that you run it in safe mode, in which it is read-only. It's going to be able to make some intelligent guesses about what it should ask you for approval for, but generally it's not going to make any changes onto your file system. One is the other extreme, where it basically just has full access to everything in your computer, and it never ever asks you for any prompts. So it's just going to run at full speed ahead. And the default one will just give you typical write access to your workspace and occasionally prompt you whenever it thinks it needs approval. And I think that's all you really need to think about when it comes to this whole sandbox and approvals mindset. Because I think that all these different combinations actually just creates complexity that is not required for day-to-day use. So this is my recommendation. Now, the problem that you will have is that now you're going to have to think about running Codex, and then you have to think about what sandbox option you're going to need. You wanted to go to the safe mode, right? You're going to have to type Codex, and then you're going to have to do sandbox equals to read only, right? And you can double check that it's actually set correctly. You want to do the dangerous one. You're going to have to do Codex, sandbox, danger, full access, and then never. Ask for approval. And so you run it this way and you can check your status and you can see it has been set. Yes, but let me show you the way that you want to actually be doing this so that you can customize it for your needs. So what you want to do is that you want to open up your home directory's Codex, and then there's something called config.toml. And within here, you will see that I've actually created 3 different profiles, safe, default, and danger, what we saw earlier. And so I would highly suggest that you follow this model such that with this, now you can run Codex and then you can do minus dash dash profiles, or you can just do minus P and then you can pass in safe. And you can see it will automatically set the approval and the sandbox for you. It works the same way if you wanted to pass in for default or if you wanted to put in for danger. This is just going to be a lot quicker for you to switch between the different profile modes. Codex does have some aliases such as this, which then sets things correctly for you, as you will see over here. But the problem with this is that you are then relying on Codex defining these internally. And I think it's a lot more helpful to set it up in this way so it suits your needs, because this is how I think it works practically for me, but you might find something else works better. And it's always better to put the power in your own hands. The next thing I'm going to show you is what you would want to do every time you start a new project. Very similar to Cloud Code, you run init, but rather than it creating a cloud.md file, it actually creates an agents.md file. So what it will do is that it will scan through your existing repository and then utilize the information that it gathers to give Codex and the agent a better context around what the project is about. Now, the great thing about agents.md is that unlike cloud.md, it's actually a universally used format for multiple different agents. So it's not just Codex related, it's actually used for several other models as well, for several other IDEs, editors, and agentic tools as well. In all honesty, it's not too different from cloud.md. It's just that you can actually run cloud and then just use the same context that you would use for your cloud.md file into agents.md. Now, while this goes on and tries to continue to look through your directory to populate this agents.md file, I'll take the time to mention something that you definitely want to be doing. Now, you will see here that whenever it's searching within your computer, it's actually using this command. One of the problems with using for the searches is that, especially when you have a big repository of folders and files, you probably want to use something that's a little bit more modern. So what I'm going to show you here once this is done is tell your Codex agent to use a different set of commands that will make your searching for files a lot faster. Because as you can see here, this is not even a very big repository that I have right over here, but you can already see that it's taking a while because it has to find stuff and then it's going to read the files. And what you want to do is be in a position where you can do this a lot quicker. So while this is going, I'm just going to let this run till completion, and I'm going to show you the prompts that I have over here. So I've created something called Fast Tools over here. And what it does is that it replaces several of the very slow default commands like grep and find and ls with some other tools that perform a lot faster. And with this prompt that you can then put into your agents.md, and this happens for things like content search, listing files, finding files, and other things like JSON processing as well. All you have to do is just copy and paste this and place it at the bottom of your agents.md file so that your Codex agent will be able to pick this pattern up. However, it's actually worthwhile noting that a lot of these apps like RG, FD, and JQ may not be part of your system installation by default. You need to go ahead and actually install this. You will see here that you actually need to install several of these things based on your operating system before you'll be able to make use of the different tools that you see over here. I've made this available, get hold of this agents.md file, as well as the installation instructions. I've made all of this available as part of my builder pack, which you can access for free in the link in the description below. So you can see here that init has created an initial understanding of this code base. And so, like I mentioned before, if you want to, you can just grab all of these prompts that you see over here and then just paste it at the bottom of the file. And so what will happen after this is that the next time you run Codex, you will actually make use of these faster commands. It will make use of these faster tools that will enable your Codex to run a lot quicker. So I've actually just Ctrl-C out of my running Codex instance. And if you're familiar with Cloud Code, you will know about how to resume your sessions. And this was missing from Codex CLI until very recently. So as of version 0.33, you are actually able to resume and continue from your sessions as well. So what you can do is just do Codex, and then you do resume. And this will give you a nice list, very much like Cloud Code, of the different sessions that you would like to pick from. Another thing that you can also do is to use continue, which will always pick the last relevant session. As you can see here, we have the whole context of the conversation and it's as we left off. Now that we've actually appended this at the bottom of our file, I'll just show this to you. So I'm going to run init one more time. All right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say find the place and file in this code base that will be where I can define more custom prompts. All right, and so this is just a generic statement. This is just an instruction that I've given to Codex right now. And so what you will see, all right, so down here, I'm going to say, find the location where the string CDX appears and list all the files. All right, and this will be a nice segue into what this is. All right, so I'm just looking for a particular string. And what you will see here is that, and now you can see that it's done the search and that tells me all the files that contain this. And if you do Control T to see the transcript over here, you will see that now it's running RG as the command to search for these files. This is a lot faster, and it's definitely something that you want to have in place in your agents.md so that Codex runs a lot quicker. Now, in order for you to actually make use of these additional tools, you will need to install several of these dependencies manually, depending on your operating system. I've created a custom prompt. This is essentially the same thing as custom slash commands in Cloud Code. And I've created this setup fast tools slash command. The way it works is that if you go to prompts and just paste this within there and save it, when you run Codex again, it will now have this new prompt called setup fast tools. And effectively, what it'll do is that it'll actually append All of these instructions on making it use these replacement tools automatically at the end of your agents.md file. So this is demonstrating one of the capabilities of using slash commands or prompts as they're called in Codex CLI. And this will make it much easier for you to just set up everything so you have both the prompts as well as the tools installed within your environment. All right, so now that we've covered pretty much everything that I think you need to know when you are getting started with using Codex, especially if you're coming to Cloud Code, I wanted to just show you something that I've built, which you might want to make use of in order to make this first experience a lot better. I've actually created a new tool called CDX, and it's effectively a tool to get you up and running with Codex CLI faster than ever. So one thing they want to know is that you are able to run Code CDX update, and this will automatically check your current version against what's available out there, and then it will update it if there's a mismatch. And this is much better than typing the whole npm install minus g openai slash codex by yourself. Okay, so that's the first one. Now, the next thing that you want to do is that, as you recall, a lot of the things that relate to Codex's configuration lies within the codex slash config bar. As we saw previously, this is where you specify profiles and several other things that relate to the project. However, I don't really like going all the way into my home directory to look for stuff. So what you can do is that I've created a few helper commands. So what you can do is the CDX profiles, and it will automatically list all of the profiles that you can find within your home directory as well. Run CDX, and then you can just pass in the profile that you want over here. All right, and one of the great things about this is that if you actually look into the source file of CDX, what I've done is that I passed in some default next step always run. So I'm always using GPT-5 and passing in the high reasoning effort and the auto summary as well as search. So whenever I run CDX, I know that it's term on search. I don't have to pass in all these random parameters consistently because I know I always want them. So basically, you can actually just go in here and make changes and set these things up. But just say you might want to be able to pass in the usual codex parameters. So all you have to do is just CDX and then double dash. And then after that, you can pass in anything but once. So remember the whole thing about swapping out the tools that I use for searching within the files and the prompts that you had to do and where you had to place them. I've made it much easier for you to do that. So all you have to do is do CDX prompts. And what you will see here is that you will see that there's actually a setup fast tools prompt. And so all you have to do is do CDX prompts install. And by default, it will install everything that it sees. So you will see here, it says install setup fast tools. So now this has been placed within your Codex folder. So now when you run Codex and then you run setup fast tools, install all the dependencies that you need, all of the instructions to your agents.md file within your project so that you don't have to manually copy and paste things around. All right, so there's a few other things that I've included over here. The Codex resume functionality sometimes doesn't work. And prior to releasing that functionality, I actually built my very own version of this by doing CDX resume. And as you can see here, it actually works very similarly. So I think if this tools, I find myself utilizing this CDX, it's not only shorter, but it's also got a lot of additional things that I find my workflow a lot quicker and faster. And this is still fairly experimental. I've found myself utilizing this a lot more as part of my workflow because it aligns a lot better and it removes a lot of the overhead of having to jump around between different folders and files and having to remember what parameters to pass in, and it just works for me. So I've made this CDX tool available, which you can grab hold of in the link in the description below. It's completely open source, so any feedback, improvements, or suggestions is definitely welcome. All right, so this brings us to the end of today's video. I really hope that this has been helpful for you to get up to speed with what Codex CLI offers, especially if you're coming from a Cloud Code background. So I hope that by bundling all these hacks into this video tutorial, as well as the CDX tool, helps you to get up to speed a lot faster. So if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a like, hit that subscribe button, and don't forget to turn on notifications so that you're always the first to know whenever new content like this. And while this is on Codex, if you're interested in learning more about Cloud Code and how they get the best out of it, you might want to check out this other video that shows you an end-to-end flow of how you utilize Cloud Code in the best way to build your applications faster and more accurately. Well, that's it for today. I'll see you next time.